You may have heard of this expression that DNA codes for protein or for polypeptides, which are the building blocks of protein. And I want to show you in what language DNA codes for polypeptides and how that language is read. And so let's take a look at a chromosome. And if you were to take a closer look at a chromosome, you'd see that it's made up of a tremendous amount of DNA, all coiled up and wound up together. So we have DNA right here. And we're going to take a look at a very, very small segment of DNA that I kind of marked off with these lavender lines. And that would be a gene. And typically a gene codes for one polypeptide, for one chain of amino acids. And at some point, this gene will undergo transcription. And that means that an enzyme, RNA polymerase, will come along and make a strand of mRNA that's complementary to one of the DNA strands. And the DNA strand that it uses to make the mRNA is called the template strand. And the RNA polymerase doesn't pick the template strand arbitrarily. There are actually certain signals that will tell the RNA polymerase to pick one strand over the other, as one DNA strand over the other as a template, but we just won't get into those details right now. And so let's take a closer look at our DNA and the mRNA that we just made off of that DNA right here at the bottom left. And so you can see that all of the nucleotides on the mRNA are complementary to the nucleotides on the DNA, with the one caveat being that in RNA, we have uracil or U instead of thymine. So wherever you would think to put a T, instead we put a U, which is uracil. And the mRNA will eventually land up in the ribosome, that's right here on the right, and the ribosome will translate the mRNA, and that means that it's going to kind of read it and put together the corresponding polypeptide chain. And so I just want to make it very clear that the DNA does not end up in the ribosome, it's only the mRNA strand that's read by the ribosome. And so every three nucleotides on the mRNA, and actually also on the DNA, is called a codon. And I'm just going to circle all the codons on the mRNA. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 codons on our mRNA, and actually also 7 codons on our DNA. And each codon is going to code for one amino acid. And let's see how that's done. So this chart that you're looking at, which is hopefully not too complicated, is the genetic code. It's the language in which amino acids are coded for and then put together into these long polypeptide chains by the ribosome. So in our upper right-hand side, I actually redrew our original DNA and its corresponding mRNA, but remember, it's the mRNA that's read and not the DNA. And you can actually see that by looking at the genetic code. You can see that it's written in RNA language because there are U's and there are no thymines, so that kind of clues you in that it's written in RNA language. So let's actually look at the mRNA that we have and let's read it. Let's see what the ribosome would do if it encountered this exact piece of RNA. So we'll start with our first codon, AUG. So the way to read this chart is you start with the left side where it says first base in codon, and we look for the first base in our codon, which is A. And so we bracket that off and we're going to be looking at that row. Then for the second base, we look at the top of the chart where it says second base in codon and we find U. And here it is, we're going to bracket off this particular column. And then for the last base, we look at the right-hand side of the chart where it says third base in codon, and we're looking at the part that was bracketed off by the row and column that we just looked at. So in this area, and we're going to look for G. And that's right here. We draw a line and we get the amino acid methionine. So AUG codes for methionine. And in fact, AUG doesn't just code for methionine, it also tells the ribosome to start translation. So I'm going to write start right over here. Let's look at our second codon, GUU. So we start with the left-hand side. We look for G. That's right over here. Then we look at the top of the chart and we look for U. So that is right over here. And then we look at the right-hand side and look for U in this particular area between those two lines. And that gives us the amino acid valine. So GUU codes for valine. Let's look at our next codon, CCC. So at the left side, we find C, bracket off that row. Then we find C on top, bracket off that column, and then find C on the right. So CCC codes for proline. Let's do the next one, AAG. I'm going to go a bit faster here. So we find A, bracket it off, then look for A on top, and then look for G. It's a little bit hard to see under that line, but we get the amino acid lysine. So AAG codes for lysine. And the next one, GUU. So in fact, we already have the codon GUU. The second codon was GUU, so I'm not going to go over how to find it again. I'll just put in valine. Let's look at the next one, GUC. Let's find G right over here, and then U on top. So I'm going to put the bracket here, and then C. We get valine. That's interesting. We have two different codons that are both coding for the amino acid valine. Let's do our last codon, UAA. So we find U, and then A on top, and then A on the right, and we get stop. So UAA does not code for an amino acid, but it tells the ribosome to stop translation. So there we go. We've synthesized our polypeptide chain. It's made up of methionine, then valine, proline, lysine, valine, and valine. And there are a couple of important things that you should keep in mind about the genetic code. The first is that it's universal. And what I mean by that is that all organisms, all the way from bacteria to plants to animals, all use the same genetic code to code for their amino acids and polypeptide chains. The second thing to keep in mind about the genetic code is that it's degenerate, which is just a fancy way of saying redundant. And that means that you can have more than one codon that code for the same amino acid. And we actually had an example of this in our polypeptide chain. We had two codons, GUU and GUC, that are different, but they both code for valine. So that's what we mean when we say that the genetic code is degenerate or redundant. And in fact, if you look at the chart, you can see that the genetic code is actually very redundant. There are many codons that code for the same amino acid. If you look right over here, for example, there are actually 6 different codons that all code for the amino acid leucine. And the third thing to keep in mind about the genetic code is that although it's degenerate, it is not ambiguous. And that means that each codon can only code for one amino acid. A codon can never code for two different amino acids. So if you look at the upper left-hand side, for example, let's look at the codon UUU. That codes for phenylalanine. So UUU always codes for phenylalanine. It will never ever code for a different amino acid.